And now the call to worship. The Lord is my shepherd, I lack nothing. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside quiet waters. He refreshes my soul. He guides me along the right paths for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the darkest valley, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows. Surely your goodness and love will follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Please join us with hymn number 611, Joyful, Joyful, We Adore Thee.
All right, we're going to start off with a little game. So if none of you up here can guess, we're going to play prop charades. If none of you can guess the correct answer, everyone else feel free to guess what I'm doing. All right, so here we go. I have my prop, and it's a blanket. So I'm going to do something with this blanket, and you have to guess what I'm doing, okay?
My baby,
Jaylen,
has that kind of blanket.
What am I doing? What am I? A superhero. Good job. All right, let's do another one. William, what am I doing? Surfing, I'm catching waves. Okay, here's another one. Fishing, let's see, I have another one. Say driving? Anybody? Who said it? Walking the dog. Walking the dog. All right. And let's see, one more. Yeah, I'm wearing a scarf. I'm keeping warm. Winter, yes. It kind of feels like that right now, doesn't it? Okay, so as you have probably seen when you walked in, there's some blankets. And if you Blankets are, you could do so much with a blanket now that you see what I did. And maybe we'll play more later. But if you donate money, you can donate a blanket to someone who needs it. But I think the people who need it, it's more for like comfort and warmth and protection, not to surf on. So keep in mind that it's good to be charitable, and there's people all over the world that do need blankets. They need warmth, they need comfort and protection. Last year in, I think it was Ohio, there was about 15 tornadoes that touched down, and people needed warmth and comfort. And your generosity would be greatly appreciated. We're going to read today about a woman named Tabitha when we go to our classrooms. And she was also a very charitable person. She sewed for people. I wonder if she sewed any blankets to keep anyone warm. Today's also Mother's Day. How are moms like blankets? Anyone know? I know that sounds kind of silly, but how can a mom be like a blanket, Cadence? They can keep us warm. How else are moms like blankets? What are they? For cuddling, they do, they cuddle with us. Go ahead. Thank you, they're comforting. They keep us safe, they keep us warm, yes. For babies, sure. It's my own child that says that.
Sometimes they're superheroes.
There you go. That's right, they are superheroes, that's for sure. They do. So today, when you think about donating a blanket to someone, think about it keeping warm, and think about the blanket keeping someone safe, and make sure you hug a mom out there today also. All right, so let's bow our heads and pray. Loving God, thank you for the things that give us comfort, and pray that we can continue to grow generous hearts so that we can help provide comfort for our neighbors in need. Amen. So now we're going to use this as a car to drive down to our classrooms. Except 5th through 8th graders are staying in today.
And now the call to confession. As followers of Jesus, and together as the body of Christ, let us confess our sins against God and our neighbors. Please join me in the prayer of confession. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your name. Amen.
Our Lord wants, we put a lot of emphasis on walking in his ways, but let's not forget that Jesus wants us to delight in being a Christian, in being a believer, in being a follower. And he brings us to that place of delight by clearing the decks, by wiping our sin away, by giving us this, what you might call blanket forgiveness. No? Mm-hmm. Good. He forgives our sins and wipes them all away and gives us new life, gives us new opportunity, gives us a new start. So thanks be to God who gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ, the victory over sin, the victory over fear, victory over death. In his name, in his power, we are forgiven. Hallelujah. Amen.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you. Will you share that peace with one another? And please remain standing for our response to grace after the passing of the peace. 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 That takes me back. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, thank you for Jesus and his love that sets us free, his love that surrounds us and abides in us, his love that lives inside of us. Thank you for the love of Jesus that makes everything different, that changes everything. Thank you for his and your willingness to be here, to be one of us, to live this crazy life, to suffer and to experience joy and sorrow, and to know what we go through, so that when we turn to Jesus, he gets it. He gets us. And he loves us through all of it. Lord, thank you for Jesus. Thank you that he is the reason that we are here, that his new covenant of love for God and love for neighbor make everything revolve around love. And thank you for teaching us through his example, through his word, that there is nothing more important than love. Nothing that makes life worth living more than love. And nothing that we can take with us from this life to the next, except the love we have given and the love we have received. Thank you. We come with grateful hearts. And we come seeking to extend that gratitude that we have for you to others. Thank you for the opportunity to provide blankets, to provide comfort and care to those who really need it, at the time they really need it, in the circumstances when they really need it. Lord, help us to understand that that is the Christian response to the love that you have given us. To make tangible, to make real, to make effective that love that you have given us. Lord, we pray for those who are in hospitals and nursing homes, for Christine and Marion and Dot. We pray for those who are recovering, for Steve and Tom, Linda, Leroy, Elsie, Stan, Hank, Michael. Pray for those who are experiencing COVID, when we had all hoped that it was over. Lord, we pray for our mission workers and for mission workers throughout the world, sacrificing for others. And Lord, this morning we're thankful for the women in our lives. We're thankful for the women who supported you, Lord, who were the first witnesses to the resurrection. We're thankful for how you honored them and trusted them and believed in them when few others did. And we thank you for all of those who have been mothers to us. Our Sunday school teachers, our neighbors, our aunts, our grandmothers, our friends. Lord, I thank you for all of the wonderful women in my life who have made a difference and helped me to see the joy of love and who have been patient with me and loved me through difficulties and who have brought joy into my life. So, Lord, we pray for all of the wonderful women in our lives today. And we give you thanks for just everything that they are, everything that they have been. We thank you for our special women in our lives who have passed away. But we remember today especially how much they mean to us and how they have left lasting footprints of love in our lives. And so with thankful and grateful hearts, we share now the prayer that you have taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, power, and the glory forever. Amen. And now we'll be blessed with our anthem for this morning.
Was your foe, still your love fought for me. You have been so, so good to me. When I felt no worth, you paid it all for me on that cross. You have been so, so all the overwhelming. till I'm found leaving the 99. And I couldn't earn it, I don't deserve it. Still you give yourself away.
Just puts you in a really nice place, doesn't it? That just lovely, beautiful, kind of soft. Will you pray with me the prayer for illumination? Oh Lord, open our hearts and minds by the power of your Holy Spirit, that we may, and the word proclaimed, we may hear with joy what you have to say to us today. Amen. I always want to get to "we may hear with joy" sooner than I should. So. Have you noticed that I like to have sermon titles that get you thinking? Vice Grip, what kind of title is that for a sermon? I'm glad you asked. Let's go to the next one. The next slide, please. I brought Vice Grip with me today. I hope that you have one of these because they're pretty indispensable, but they look like regular pliers, but they're special because you can take something and you can adjust them and you can lock it on, and then there's no way you can, so when it's locked, it's locked. When a vice grip locks on you, it never lets go. Starting to get it? Vice grips. All right. I don't know what this was, but it's wonderful. I found it hanging around, and we'll find some use for it. Well, this is going to be easy for you to relate to because it's winter in Jerusalem, and winter in Jerusalem is like this today. All right? It doesn't rain in Israel from April to October. Not at all. It's just dry. And starting in November a little bit, and then in December and January and February, that's the rainy season. It's the only time that it rains. And it's somewhere between mid-50s, mid-40s. Cold. Remember, there are no down jackets, right? There are no fuzzy boots. There's nothing to keep you warm except that inner tunic and your outer robe. And it's winter. It's the festival of dedication. We know the festival of dedication as Hanukkah. All right? So it's Hanukkah, and Jesus is in Jerusalem, and it's cold, and it's probably raining. It was winter, and Jesus was in the temple courts walking in Solomon's colonnade. Next, please. This is a picture of the temple, and the area on this side is Solomon's colonnade, all right? And it's these covered porticos where Jesus likes to go and spend time and teach out of the wind, out of the rain, as out of the cold as you can be outdoors. Next, I'll give you more of a close-up of it, that area that you see behind the little place. That's Solomon's colonnade. That's where Jesus liked to go and teach when he was in Jerusalem, especially during this period of time and in this kind of weather. So he's there in Solomon's colonnade. And the Jews who were there gathered around him. Now, this is from the Gospel according to John. And when John writes about the folks that are around Jesus, he has two groups of folks, because everyone's Jewish in Jerusalem, but he differentiates between the crowd and the Jews. The crowd are all of the people, and the Jews are the Jewish religious leaders, the authorities, the ones that have it all together, the ones that have the power, the ones that cooperate and collude with the Romans, the ones who are trying to get rid of him. He refers to them as the Jews. So these are not normal, regular Jewish people. These are the Jewish leaders who are out to silence Jesus because he's upsetting their whole power structure. You with me? So when he says the Jews, that's who he's talking about. So the Jews who are there, of course, not to learn from Jesus, but to try to trap him, as they always are, gathered around him saying, well, how long will you keep us in suspense? If you're the Messiah, tell us plainly, because they want him to get himself into as much trouble as he can. And Jesus is too smart for them, but that's what they're after. And Jesus answered, I did tell you. And he has in a number of ways. But you do not believe. The works I do in my Father's name testify about me. So Jesus always kind of says the same thing when people say, well, tell us whether you're the Messiah or not. Jesus says, look at what I've done. Look at what I do. I heal the sick. I heal the blind. I bring sight to people. I touch them and they're healed. The things that I do are the things that your prophets, our prophets, said that only the Messiah could do. And he says, look at the works I do. They testify about me, but you do not believe because you are not my sheep. Now, this is in the chapter that we call the Good Shepherd chapter. John is very impressed as he thinks back about his time with Jesus. And he's impressed by the image of Jesus as the Good Shepherd. First of all, it's odd because nobody in Jesus' time would want to admit to being a shepherd, because shepherds were low life. They were dirty and smelly and the last people that anybody would want to be with. Isn't it cool that God announces with all the angels that Jesus has been born to the shepherds? And not just the shepherds, I like to point out to the night shift guys. All right, so... But Jesus is the Good Shepherd, and he begins this chapter by saying, the Good Shepherd lays down his life for the sheep. Man, John is just captured by that and wants to flesh out this this understanding, this beautiful picture of Jesus as the good shepherd. Because sheep are dependent on the shepherd. Sheep are helpless. Sheep are not that smart. Okay? They get in all kinds of trouble, and the shepherd has to take care of them. And the way the shepherd handles the sheep is that they learn his voice. The sheep know the voice of the shepherd, and he calls to them, and they follow him. He says, "My sheep, listen to my voice. I know them, and they follow me. I give them eternal life, and they shall never perish. No one will snatch them out of my hand." Now I want to go through this. Look at these promises from Jesus with me. Because these are promises for us. He's not talking about someone else. He's talking about you and me. And look at what he says. They're mine. They're my sheep. I want to be his sheep. If I have to be a sheep, and I am, because I'm not that smart, and I get in trouble too much, I want to be Jesus' sheep. I want his voice to be the one I'm following. He says, they're mine. I give them eternal life. Sometimes we lose sight of that. As foundational and fundamental as it is, we start to believe that we earn our salvation by being good and doing stuff and coming to church and all of the stuff that we do out of gratitude. We start to kind of get off the track and believe that we do that because we've earned our salvation and we deserve our salvation. And Jesus says, no, it's a gift. It's a gift. We're here to say thank you for the gift of salvation. He says, I give them eternal life and they shall never perish. Say it. Never perish. That wasn't good enough. Never perish. How much about this world can you say never? The older I get, the more I'm surprised when somebody says something like, well, I never thought that could happen. Or he would never do that. Or that he could never say that. Or there never gets farther and farther away. But when Jesus Christ says never, he means never. No fine print, no read the back, no getting out of it. It's never. He says, they shall never perish. That part of you and me, that part of you and me that makes us who we are, that where love comes from, where joy comes from, where tears come from, where just laughter comes from, the piece of you and me that is unique to you and unique to me, that piece where Jesus lives, where God loves us, where God created us, that part of us never ever, ever will perish because of the gift of salvation in Jesus Christ. And he says, no one will snatch them out of my hand. The vice grip. The grip of Jesus on you and me is locked on. And Jesus promises us that once he is locked onto us, nothing can ever pull us apart. Nothing can ever pull us away. That his vice grip love locks on and nothing can shake that. There's so much in life that just we can't count on, that we think we can count on, that we thought we could count on, that now is shaky at best and maybe vanished at worst. But Jesus says, no, I'll give you something you can count on. When my love locks onto you, I'll never let you go. And then he doubles down on that. After saying, nothing can ever snatch you out of my hand, then he doubles down with the Father. He says, my Father has given you to me, and he's greater than anything. And no one can snatch them out of his hand, and I and the Father are one. Wow, he just ends with this wonderful bombshell that He doesn't come out and say the words, I'm the Messiah, but don't you think that I and the Father are one pretty much says that? Well, they did, because the next thing that happens is they pick up stones. Isn't it interesting how there were stones hanging around? They picked up stones that they brought with them, hoping that he would say something like that. They pick up stones to stone him, but he's smarter than they are, and he outwits them, and they end up going away with their heads hanging down. They don't get to him this time. They will. We know they will. But we also know that that was part of God's plan to have Jesus make the perfect sacrifice for us. The hands of Jesus. I'm fascinated by the hands of Jesus. The vice grip of Jesus. The hands of Jesus are holding on to you today. Whatever you're going through, wherever you are, wherever you've been, whatever you've done, whatever happens today and tomorrow and the next day, the grip of Jesus, the hands of Jesus are holding on to you. And those are the same hands that touched the woman who had been bent over for 17 years and straightened her up. Those are the same hands that broke the bread and held out the cup to share his own body and his own blood with the disciples and with you and me. The hands of Jesus that are holding on to you are the hands that raised up the woman who others wanted to stone and bid her go and sin no more. The hands of Jesus are the hands that called forth Lazarus from the tomb and wrapped his arms around his now living friend who was dead and alive again. The hands of Jesus are the hands that beckoned Zacchaeus, the hated tax collector, to come down from the tree and went to his house for dinner and loved him into the kingdom. The hands of Jesus are the hands that stretched out on the cross and said, "I give my life for the sheep." The hands of Jesus are the bleeding hands that will welcome you and me to heaven. Those hands with their scars will wipe away yours and make us perfect and bring us into the very presence of God the Father. The hands of Jesus are the hands that will reach out to you and me when our time here on earth is done and welcome us to heaven. And the hands of Jesus are the hands that will be holding on to you with vice grip love and vice grip power and vice grip security, now and forever. Amen. Our ushers will come forward and receive our morning tithes and offerings, and we have a special offertory musical selection.
She never went to bed till late, yet I never heard her complaining about her family of eight. There were times she should have been sleeping late in the midnight hour. She'd get down on her knees and you could hear her say, "Lord, fill them with your power." Mama liked to burn the midnight oil down on her knees and If you ask her why she did it, she said she did it 'cause she cared. Mama knew that Jesus was waiting when she knelt by her rocking chair. Oh, I'm glad my mama was willing to burn the midnight oil in prayer. My mama's gone to be with Jesus. I've got a family of my own. Yet whenever the clock strikes midnight, you will find me all alone. That's when I start to call upon Jesus for his wisdom and his power. 'Cause it seems that he loves to hear a daddy's prayer, even in the midnight hour. Mama liked to burn the midnight oil down on her knees in prayer. If you ask her why she did it, she said she did it 'cause she cared. Mama knew that Jesus was waiting when she knelt by her rocking chair. Oh, I'm glad my mama was willing to burn the midnight oil in prayer. Years from now, when my grown little boy has a family of his own, will he kneel down and pray when the hour is late and pass the legacy on? Mama liked to burn the midnight oil down on her knees in prayer. If you ask her why she did it, she said she did it 'cause she cared. Mama knew that Jesus was waiting when she knelt by her rocking chair. Oh, I'm glad my mama was willing to burn the midnight oil in prayer. Now there's a grandpa who's willing to burn the midnight oil in prayer.
Praise God.
God of new life, out of the abundance of our lives, we offer these gifts to you. Through your blessing and our willingness to share, may these offerings become a source for hope and love in this church family and in the community beyond us, in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Please remain standing for our closing hymn, number 269, Lead On, O King Eternal. Thank you. Lead on, O King The Lord watch over you as your days increase, bless and guide you wherever you may be, strengthen you when you stand, comfort you when discouraged or sorrowful, raise you up if you fall, and finally in your hearts may the peace that passes understanding abide all the days of your life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.